Thank you very much for this kind introduction. And it's a topic which I would like to discuss within the next 25 minutes around is the impaired eye movement. And as you can imagine, that there are multiple reasons why you can have impaired eye movement. And I will discuss the intrinsic reasons for impaired eye movement, which can be either due to inflammation, which can be due to a tumor. The tumor, of course, can be divided into benign and malignant tumor. For instance, optic nerve sheath meningioma can cause impaired eye movement. Schwannomas, neurofibromas can cause this. But of course, you also have a variety of malignant lesions located in and in the surrounding of their orbit, for instance, lymphomas, metastases, rhabdomyosarcomas, optic nerve gliomas, which can also cause some impaired eye movement. And of course, you have many extrinsic factors influencing the mobility of the eye. And again, we have inflammation, we have trauma, and we have the tumors, again, benign and malignant tumors. And of course, as a third group, you have always all the neurogenic reasons for impaired eye movement, infarction, multiple sclerosis, and so on. But I have to skip due to time reasons. I have to skip all the neuro reasons for impaired eye movement. So I will focus on these two groups mainly. And I would like to start with the inflammation, because the inflammation actually is probably the most common reason, in summary, where you have impaired eye movement. And if you talk about inflammation, then I believe that the reason which is located in the sinus, in the paranasal sinuses, is the largest group which is affecting the orbit. And as soon as you have a complication of your sinusitis, you sometimes have impaired eye movement. And even if you have a small infiltration of inflammation of the eye, for instance, a preceptor cellulitis with eyelid swelling, you can have already impaired eye movement. And of course, if you have an abscess or if you have a superiostal abscess, or these other types, for instance, sinus thrombosis and so on, of course, this all is resulting in impaired eye movement. And I would like to give you some ideas how it can look like and give you some examples on inflammations, on tumors and so on, which is causing impaired eye movement. And this is actually the minor version, preceptal cellulitis with eyelid swelling. This can be either unilateral or bilateral. And here on this image, you see this eyelid swelling here on both sides here. It is more prominent on the right side compared to the left side. Here you have it on both sides in a minor version. So you can imagine if you have such extensive swelling of the eyelid that the globe is limited in the movement because it is packed within the orbit, and therefore the movement of the eye is limited. It is always the question for imaging, why do you have this eyelid swelling? Is there maybe a reason within the paranasal sinuses? Do you have an obstruction of the infundibulum on the pathways? Or is it just inflammation of the eyelid itself, as it's shown here, for instance? And here you see not a big affection of the paranasal sinuses. This is another example here. You have here an abscess in the inferior eyelid. You see this here in the sagittal reconstruction. And if you see this in the coronal or in the sagittal reformation, you see that the maxillary sinus is fine. So the reason for this abscess is not a paranasal sinus problem. It is a localized problem in the inferior eyelid, but you see this is already pushing the globe in cranial direction, and therefore the movement of the globe is of course limited. And you see it also here in the axial reformation, but this is still a limited disease because it is not affecting the intraconal fat of the orbit. And the sinus, which is related to the orbit, is quite normal in this case. So the treatment is limited and can be treated locally. In this situation, it is a little bit different because this is already a severe orbital complication of the sinusitis. The ethmoid sinus is most often the source for orbital complication, but of course also the sphenoid, the maxilla, or the frontal sinus can be the origin. And if you see this image here on the axial slice, you see, of course, you have the subperiosteal abscess here on the left side. The left ethmoid sinus is obliterated. You have this swallowing here on the left eye. You see here the clinical image. Of course, this is already impressive. And you know, if you see this red color here, the swelling, the patient is normally not able to open the eye anymore, then you know that there is something wrong. And the question for us as radiologists is, where is the disease located, and maybe where is the reason for this? And if you see this with a complete obliteration of the maxillary sinus, the infundibulum, the osteomedial complex is completely obliterated, and then you see, especially in the reformation, you see where the superiosteal abscess is located, and you see that this is still extraconal. It is not clear sometimes on the axials, therefore I would always recommend to do the reformation, but here you see the superior and the medial rectus muscles, the intraconal fat is normal, and here you have the superiosteal abscess, which is caused by the inflammation of the paranasal sinus here on the left side, and this can occur also in children. For instance, this is a three-year-old child. You have here inflammation in the maxillary, in the ethmoid sinus here on the right side, and you see the subperiosteal abscess here on the right side pushing away the muscles, but this lesion is still not affecting the intraconal fat, so it can be treated normally via surgery of the paranasal sinuses, and then you get rid of this subperiosteal abscess normally. If this inflammation is located at a dangerous place, for instance, here you have the normal sphenoid sinus here on the left side, but the right part of the sphenoid sinus is completely obliterated. You see here in this fat-saturated T1 weighted sequence that there is a significant inflammation within this obliterated maxillary sinus, and this is not a limited disease to the sphenoid sinus here on the right side. You have already some inflammation in the adjacent structures here. The meninges are already enhancing a little bit, and if you follow here the optic channel here along the optic nerve, you see that there is also significant enhancement in this area here, which the reason, of course, is the obliteration of the sphenoid sinus here on the right side. And you see it also here in the reformation with the enhancement of the adjacent structures. But this was a disease which resulted in amaurosis of this patient at the end. And if you do not treat this inflammation here in the right time, then this can end up in amaurosis, as it was the case in this patient. And if you are even more late, then you have you can develop, for instance, an orbital abscess, and then you have the typical findings. You have a T2 weighted image here in axial and sagittal slice orientation. You see the fluid, the air fluid level here, because the patient is lying in supine position. There you have it in vertical orientation here in the sagittal reconstruction. You have it here in the axial reconstruction, and you see that the superior rectus muscle is displaced in caudal direction. You see that there is even an affection of the globe. It is not a ball anymore. There is a compression of the ball, of the globe, caused by this abscess, this orbital abscess here. And of course, if you see the paranasal sinuses here with a complete obliteration of the maxillary sinus, the ethmoid sinus, the frontal sinus, then you know that, of course, surgery is necessary in this case to get rid of this orbital abscess. And well, then they did surgery. This is a CT image with the air fluid level. And then we had done some follow-up studies with MRI. You see that the drainage is still in place here, but the abscess is gone. The globe looks quite normal again. The deformation of the globe is recurrent. and it recovered completely. And you see, due to the surgery, also the complete obliteration of the maxillary sinus improved completely. Also the ethmoid sinus here on the right side recovered a little bit, and the muscle is in a normal position, and the globe is in a normal position. So after surgery, the patient recovered completely. If you are not doing surgery in early enough, then you can have severe intracranial complications, for instance, resulting in a brain abscess, as shown here. Another reason which is not causing immediate clinical signs of inflammation with impaired eye movement can be another complication of a chronic sinusitis, again affecting very often the orbit and resulting in impaired eye movement. And a very common finding is a mucocele. Here you have an example of a mucocele originating from the frontal and the ethmoid sinus, which is actually the most common localization for a mucocele. And if you see this here, you have the thinning of the lamina papyracea here on the right side. The medial rectal muscle is pushed away. The globe is pushed away a little bit. This is the mucocele. And of course, the clinical symptoms, again, impaired eye movement, double images, and so on. Another examples for mucocele here in the frontal sinus, the maxillary sinus. All of these can cause some impaired eye movements. This is an extensive mucocele in the frontal sinus with the thinning of the bony walls and the deossification, which you can see here nicely on the CT images. But of course, we have other reasons for impaired eye movement, sometimes not a real infection, not a real complication of a sinusitis. Sometimes after blowing the nose, you can have extensive emphysema in the orbit, which is shown here. You see the air collection here in the extraconal area on the left orbit. And of course, this is again causing some swelling and then at the end impaired eye movement. And it is very difficult on your images to find the entrance point where was the reason located for this emphysema of the orbit on the left side after blowing the nose. Then you can have really aggressive inflammation, sclerosing, dacoadenitis, which is shown here on the T1 weighted image plane and here with contrast. And you see that the whole globe is impacted actually in this aggressive sclerosing dacoadenitis. This is an inflammation which is really covering the whole globe and is almost fixating the globe in this position. And you see it quite nicely here on our MR images. And you see also on the left side, this is not a normal lacrimal duct here on the left side, but of course it's much more prominent here on the right side. Besides this inflammation, of course, you have a variety of tumors which are located in the orbit and which can cause an impairment of the eye movement. And maybe one of the most common lesions which you can see here is a hemangioma. This is a typical finding of a hemangioma. It is well circumscribed, sharp borders here. You have a strong contrast enhancement. You see it here in the axial slice orientation, in the coronal slice orientation after gadolinium administration. So this is a typical finding of a hemangioma, and it is actually quite easy in the differential diagnosis. But you can also have some other tumors, for instance, optic nerve sheath meningiomas, as you can see here on the left side. This is affecting the optic channel here on the left side. The muscles are also a little bit compressed, and therefore the movement of the eye is again impaired. And you see it quite nicely here on the T1 weighted image already. You see, if you compare the medial rectal muscle here on the on the left side with the right side, you see that you have a displacement here in this area, which is caused by the optic nerve sheath meningioma, because you have a volume effect in this area, and this is pushing away the muscle, and of course, the muscle function is limited, even if the muscle is not really infiltrated by this meningioma. But you can imagine, of course, that this is affecting the function of the muscle and affecting the eye movement. And here you have the sagittal reformation with the optic nerve sheath meningioma. The same, of course, is true for the optic nerve glioma here, with a typical finding here on the T2 weighted image, typical finding here on T1 plane and after gadolinium injection. I think this is not a real problem in the differential diagnosis. Also, other lesions which are not really related to orbital structures can be the reason for impaired eye movement. We have here a lesion which is showing strong contrast enhancement, and this lesion is showing a quite high signal intensity in the T2 weighted sequence. Therefore, it is probably not a lymphoma. Lymphoma, which maybe looks similar in the T1 weighted sequence or the contrast enhanced T1 weighted sequence with a contrast, homogeneous contrast enhancement, would show normally in the T2 weighted sequence a lower signal intensity. This lesion here is showing a quite high signal intensity in the T2 weighted sequence. You see it also here. This is more related to a schwannoma or neurinoma in this case, and if you check the localization, it was a schwannoma of the infraorbital nerve. Of course, you can also have some malignant lesions there, conjunctival carcinoma, fixating the bulb. You see that the function is not working anymore. You have the lesion here with strong contrast enhancement, and the globe is fixed by this tumor a little bit at least. And then you can have the more extensive lesions, and of course a variety of lesions can show up with metastasis in the orbital region. This is one example for a metastasis of a hepatocellular carcinoma in this area. And you see the exophthalmos here on the left side. If you compare it to the right side, you see the extensive lesion here infiltrating. The dura is infiltrated here. The bony structures are infiltrated. The temporal muscle is infiltrated. So, of course, based on the infiltration pattern of this lesion, it is not a benign lesion anymore. It is a malignant lesion. You see, of course, the whole globe is fixated here in this tumorous mass. And at the end, of course, you have to look for a primary tumor, or even sometimes it is already known, the primary tumor. I think it is very difficult, based on the images, to say whether this is a metastasis of a chest cancer or a breast cancer or a kidney cancer or whatever. Histopathology has to be taken in order to find out which is the source for this infiltration. But based on the images, of course, you can say this is a malignant lesion. The same here for a metastasis of a malignant melanoma. The medial rectus muscle is affected here. You have the thickening here. You see the contrast enhancement here in the medial rectal muscle here. You see it also here in the coronal reconstruction. And, of course, if you check the brain MRI, in addition, you have a metastasis here. A small one is showing up here. So if you have multiple lesions, then you know probably it is a malignant lesion, and then metastases are more common, of course, than the other differential diagnosis. Here, example of a metastasis of a lung cancer here on the left side. It looks quite similar to the metastasis of a hepatocellular carcinoma, also infiltrating the bony structures, the muscles, the intra- and extraconal fat is infiltrated here, the muscles are infiltrated. So we can say it is a malignant lesion, and what it is has to be done by histopathology at the end. The same, of course, is true for direct infiltration of the orbital by squamous cell carcinomas, which can grow really extensively within the orbit, within the surrounding soft tissues, but they can also follow the nerve structures infiltrating the cavernous sinus here on the left side, note also the dural enhancement here in this case and the infiltration of the masseter muscle here on the left side. Rare diseases, alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma can show some infiltration of the orbit here and affecting the function of the orbit. Again, here, if you compare the left side with the right side, you see that the muscle is pushed away a little bit. You have some kind of exophthalmos here. And of course, the function of the right globe is impaired. Some lymph node metastases are visible. In addition, again, the differential diagnosis has to be done by histopathology. This is a case where we maybe can do the differential diagnosis already based on our imaging studies. Sometimes the patient has the history of multiple polyps. Surgery was done in this patient before. And what you can see here is that the lamina papyracea on the left side is gone. You see that the medial rectal muscle is pushed away. The fat is not really infiltrated, but you have this bony destruction here. On this side, you have some reaction in the maxillary sinus here on the left side. And I show it the same patient to you in the reconstruction, in the coronal reconstruction. And you see that the bony wall, the lamina papyracea, is completely destroyed. It is not displaced or thinned compared, as you can see, for instance, in mucosal. So it is a real destruction of the bony wall, the medial orbital wall. So it is potentially a malignant lesion. Also, if you check it here, the lamina cribrosa is not very nice, visible anymore. So you can be quite sure that this is a malignant lesion. And it was a plain CT scan because this was just done for the evaluation of sinusitis. But of course, this is not sinusitis. Maybe this is sinusitis here in the maxillary sinus, but this lesion here is not. Of course, then you can add an additional imaging modality, and this is the case in a CT study here. You see low signal intensity here in the CT study. You have some high signal intensity in the maxillary sinus, indicating that there is some inflammation. I show you the plain T1 image, and then you have different signals already. High signal in the plain T1 weighted study here. You see it here. Well circumscribed, and low signal intensity in the maxillary sinus here on the left side. And if you have high signal intensity in a T1 weighted image, then you think about different differential diagnosis, fat, contrast. Contrast was not administered, so it is not contrast. Is it fat? No, if you compare it to fat. It can be protein content. Well, it looks not like a protein content, because if you see the T2 weighted sequence, then you are sure that this is not a normal protein content. So you should think about the other lesions which have high signal intensity in the T1 weighted sequence, plain. And the first differential is a melanoma. And in this case, it was a malignant melanoma infiltration after gadolinium. You see the contrast enhancement. You see the displacement of the orbital muscle. And this is normal sinusitis here on the left side. Then you can have diffuse infiltration, for instance, in chronic lymphatic leukemia, where the whole area, the intra and the extraconal fat, is diffusely infiltrated by this CLL. And of course, you can imagine that the movement of the globe is very limited in this disease. Lymphoma, I mentioned already that lymphoma typically have homogeneous contrast enhancement, but low signal intensity on the T2 weighted sequence. You see it quite nicely here. And then you have the homogeneous contrast enhancement, and this helps you in the differentiation between, for instance, neurinoma, malignant infiltration of a carcinoma or metastasis compared to the lymphoma. Huge giant aneurysm here, of course, can also affect the orbit sometimes in the movement, and also fibrous dysplasia. You can imagine if you have impact your orbiter on the left side like this, with this typical extensive fibrous dysplasia, you know the orbital movement is limited in this case. If you have extensive lymphoma, which is infiltrating the orbit, of course, also you have some infiltration and some impaired movement. And again, the differential diagnosis can be very difficult to make the right diagnosis, except if you have the typical appearance of a lymphoma, as you can see here, and if you have this perineural infiltration, which you see already here in the cavernous sinus, but you see also some contrast enhancement in the mandible here following the alveolar nerve, here in the mandibular nerve, you see it here, plane and after gadolinium. If you have this diffuse perineural spread, then you know it is probably a lymphoma, and you can put this in the differential diagnosis list quite high up. At the end, a couple of examples for trauma, which is, of course, also affecting the eye movement. Here, for instance, you have a traumatic lens luxation. In this case, it's quite easy on a CT scan. If the lens is missing, then you know that there is something wrong. Or this is an example of a foreign body, in this case, a wood foreign body affecting the orbita. This is bleeding in the globe on the left side after a globe laceration, after a trauma. You see the exophthalmos, no bleeding inside, but the globe itself was destroyed due to this trauma and the bleeding within the globe. And of course, all the blowout fractures, either as shown here, the medial blowout fracture with a displacement of the fat and sometimes the orbital muscles can cause a limitation of the eye movement, or if you have a blowout fracture, it's an inferior border of the orbit with some bleeding. This can affect the eye movement. And also here in this case with extensive, so you have the fracture of the inferior border of the orbit. And this was not a prolapse of the fat tissue. This is caused by the bleeding in the maxillary sinus and the extracoronal space of the orbit, of course, affecting the eye movement. You see again, the bulb is not a ball anymore. It is displaced here a little bit, and you have done some deformation in this area. And of course, you can have some severe injuries. This is a child with a bicycle accident, and you have, of course, an obvious impression fracture here affecting the orbita. It's the same here in this case with this multiple fractures. I think this is quite easy and not a problem for us as radiologists to make the right diagnosis. So in summary, we have multiple lesions affecting the orbit and the movement of the eye, and there are intrinsic and extrinsic causes. I think that inflammation is the most common one in the daily practice, but we have, of course, a lot of tumors which can affect the eye movement. There are some tumors in the orbit which are quite characteristic, the hemangioma, lymphoma maybe, but as soon as you are dealing with different types of metastasis, you have to wait for histopathology in order to make the right diagnosis. And if you get the optimal clinical information from your partners, I think you are able to make, in many cases, the differential diagnosis in the right way, even if it is still difficult. Thank you for your attention.